his last hour at the cross, an opportunity to be still, to be thoughtful and prayerful, and to keep company with Jesus in the last hours, the last minutes of his life. You'll see that there's a candle burning here, and this candle will be blown out at 3 o'clock, symbolizing the last breath of Jesus. In the hour, there are some hymns to listen to. There are some readings that you'll hear and some reflections, and also plenty of space for you to think and for you to listen to God. You have a stone with you, which you chose as you came in, and our encouragement to you is to hold your stone, and as you think, and as prayers come to your mind, and things that you want to leave with Jesus, make that stone symbolize those prayers, those people or those situations you want to lay at the feet of the cross, at the foot of the cross. And as you leave today, that's what you can do. You can leave your stone right there. Today is a solemn day. The day we remember the suffering and death of Christ our Lord upon the cross. The total self-giving of love for the beloved. In pain, in humiliation, in despair. Lord, as we worship you today, fill us with wonder, with gratitude, with solemn joy. In the name of our crucified Messiah, our uplifted Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We say together, come to us this day in a new way, Jesus Christ. Come as the one who is not afraid of anything in human life. Come as the brave Christ who stays in the tombs of our life and who walks towards violence and hate with a soul which shrinks from nothing. Come and convince us again that whatever we may fear, we cannot kill God. Amen. We listen to the hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, and we allow its words to find meaning in our hearts as we follow them in our booklet. Thank you.
Jesus is condemned. Wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led Jesus away into the palace, that is the Praetorium, and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews." Again and again they struck him on the head with a staff and spat on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. There's compromise here of Pilate wanting to be a crowd pleaser. The soldiers are compromised because they're involved not in an enthronement, but a mock play. Their words are hollow. And there's irony. Barabbas literally means son of the father. And he is released as the father's son is led out to die. There are so many questions in this scene, questions that we don't have all the answers to. But perhaps very simply, you and I are invited in our words, our thoughts, and our actions, invited to a choice. Compromise what is true and right, or to do justice and bring freedom and release prisoners, to condemn or to give people release. And that trial plays out in the court of our own lives. What evidence is there? How do we find ourselves?
Jesus carries his cross. But they shouted, "Take him away, take him away, crucify him." "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. We have no king but Caesar, the chief priests answered. Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. So he carried the cross piece, to which his own hands would be nailed shortly. And it was really heavy. Probably this piece of the cross would have weighed around 5 stone and would have been about 5 feet long, the height of a person, short person. And there was a long journey to make from Pilate's palace through the hot, crowded streets, jeering, to the hill outside the city gates, about 1/2 mile. And he was already battered and broken and exhausted. And we may imagine him stumbling and falling, not just once, but over and over again. And it's shocking to fall over when you're an adult. When you're a child, you just get up. But when you're an adult and you fall, you get hurt. And you also look around to see if anyone's seen you fall. And you can feel embarrassed. And Jesus was already half naked. So his falling was witnessed by many. And he was buckling under the weight of the cross that he carried. And with the cross he carried the sins of the world. Every wrong ever done by any of us or any human that's ever lived. And so as we picture him in that scene, let's be aware of what we're responsible for. What he carried that's ours.
Jesus is helped by Simon of Cyrene. A certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way in from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. When it's your own name in the Bible, you stop. Perhaps place yourself more fully in the shoes of that person and recognize your own failure to help and to be a witness. Cyrene is modern-day Libya. Church history suggests that Simon's sons became missionaries and spread the good news. The God of the world, in this one small moment, was drawing the world to himself. An innocent man helping an innocent man. And this help was given under duress and brutality, but it was given nonetheless. The healing God Jesus has no peace here. There is only temporary rest for the weary, not what we are promised by Christ. We're invited to take up our cross, but it is a heavy burden. We're invited to lose our lives, but we find reasons not to. Here Simon shares the load, and we are invited to do likewise. Not forced, but encouraged. Echoes of the Good Samaritan, not walking on by, but stopping and caring and being Christ's hands and feet and heart and mission.
Jesus is stripped and crucified. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." Part of the indignity and the agony of crucifixion is the nakedness. Jesus, God himself, stripped of any pride. The wounds on his back are torn open again. He experiences the ultimate vulnerability of the defenseless. No shield or security protects him. As they stare at him, his eyes turn to heaven. Huge nails are hammered through his hands and feet to fix him on the cross. As the cross is lifted up, the weight of his life hangs on those nails. Every time he struggles to pull himself up, to breathe, his ability to cling to life slips away. And watching, we may contemplate all that has been taken from him. We may reflect on how much of he himself he has revealed to us, spiritually, emotionally, physically. He's holding nothing back. And as we look at him in his humility, we do well to realize that this is for us. And we may feel immense gratitude. And as we watch his face, we might be thinking, there is probably no pain or agony that can be suffered by any person in this world that he doesn't identify with. He knows what it's like to struggle to breathe, to struggle to stay alive. And he knows what it's like to give up that struggle. Let's be watching his face. Thank you.
Jesus promises a place in his kingdom. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Desperate men, desperate lives, desperation. Jesus is in the middle, dividing them from one another. Perhaps they have similar stories, but they have very different responses and reactions to the centrality of Jesus on a cross in the midst of them. One is taunting, angry, lost, embittered. The other one senses the injustice and something of the glory and the goodness of God nailed to a cross. He speaks up, he speaks out, and seeks salvation. And in just 9 words, hope is given to the hopeless. Perhaps those two criminals are wrestling right now inside us, turning away and turning towards. Angry. We utter, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." We all need to hear, "Truly I tell you, today, today, you will be with me in paradise."
Jesus speaks to his mother and his friend. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there, and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. By the cross, a small group, mainly women, mainly weeping. Mary, his mother, breaking her heart. And the friend who loved him, the only one of the menfolk, it seems, who hadn't fled. It was really risky to be there. But Jesus looks down at them with love. First, he looks at his mother. "Woman, here is your son." And then he looks at his friend. "Here is your mother." And since his hands are not free to point or gesture, he has a lot of work to do pointing with his eyes, you and you, looking at one and then at the other. You belong together. And when he's through with looking and with inviting, the adoption is final. From that day on, the disciple takes her into his home. And in a gesture of surpassing sweetness, an achingly beautiful scene, he creates a new family. Not one that would have been connected naturally. Mary had a family already. She had another son. But something mattered here to Jesus about creating a family of a different kind. People who don't belong together ordinarily, but in the family of God, they really, really do. And so a question to think about for all of us today. Who are your brothers, your sisters, your mothers, your fathers, your family, spiritually? Who is it that Jesus says to you today, look after that one? Care for them. They're yours. I've made them yours. You're responsible.
Jesus dies. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." Someone ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone, let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Darkness descending, the darkness of senses pushed beyond pain, the darkness of complete solitude, the darkness of total loss, the darkness of overpowering grief, the darkness of building fear, the darkness of growing uncertainty, the darkness of dashed hope, the darkness of acute memories, the darkness of fading life, the darkness of ruptured history, the darkness of divine death, the darkness descending, the darkness that our God embraced for us.
come to a time where there is an invitation, still sitting where you are, to be very thoughtful, maybe holding your stone, of everything that you want to bring and lay at the feet of Jesus this afternoon. So this may be something that's come to mind as we've been speaking. It may be something that God has whispered into your ear in the quiet. It may be that something has not yet been heard by you, but is about to be. So I encourage you to dig deeper in the silence that's to follow, and to allow your prayers to surface. On this day of all days, O God, we bring to you all the oppressions and the suffering of this troubled world. We do this in confidence, knowing that nothing is too much or too little for you. Our prayers into the loving, healing, and costly carrying of our pain, which lies within your own body, Jesus Christ. That soon all may be changed into new life. And now we pray that we, as your earthly body, may be so transformed and inspired by your love for us that we too may absorb into our life the needs and struggles of the world and create there a miracle of grace and a leading forth into a different day. In the silence, we honour all that you have done for us and for all your people.
God who hangs before us in suffering and death is the God who would rather die than stop loving us and who offers us forgiveness. We say together, we thank you on this day, Jesus Christ, for love which surpasses human knowledge and grace which bears the pain. Listen to the music and see the words of O Sacred Head once wounded.
moment will be your time to come, and as you leave, let your stone rest at the foot of the cross. We hope that this hour has been a good, though maybe painful one for you, rightly so, perhaps, and we've kept company to the last. Thank you for being here. Now go out in quiet faith to walk that way towards the hope of Easter Day and our meeting with the risen Christ.
And may we dare to look all deathliness in the face and find the love of God waiting there behind it, calling us to follow down the dark reaches of our life into the safe arms of Jesus Christ.